Hi, I'm Cliff Lissenden, a professor of engineering science and mechanics here at Penn State, and I'm here with the PRINSE, which is a robotic inspection system that we developed for dry storage casks.
Here we see casks at Palo Verde in Arizona. Spent fuel dry storage installations are distributed around the United States. Eventually, the spent fuel will be transported to a repository for disposal. Since there is no repository as yet, the storage duration must be extended. Therefore, the integrity of the dry storage casks needs to be evaluated and the storage installations recertified. Our team has designed the PRINSE system to help. Most dry storage casks consist of a concrete and steel overpack structure surrounding a welded stainless steel canister in which the fuel assemblies are kept within a basket. The axis of the cylindrical canisters can either be vertical or horizontal. The temperature inside the cask is elevated and gamma radiation is present. Furthermore, access to the canister is severely limited. Thus, a robotic inspection system, PRINSE, is needed to provide awareness of canister degradation, such as stress corrosion cracking. While the sensing systems apply to all casks, the robotics is designed specifically for the high storm family of casks. The PRINSE project team consists of 7 faculty researchers at Penn State, the University of Michigan, South Carolina, and Illinois, as well as 34 graduate and undergraduate students. The team is guided by an advisory board composed of scientists and engineers from national labs, the Electric Power Research Institute, and Holtec International, a vendor. Steve Marshman at the Idaho National Lab is the technical point of contact. At the beginning of the project, the team developed functions and requirements for the robotic inspection system and solicited input from both the advisory board and the dry storage community. Some design premises are shown here, followed by the 4 types of sensing systems developed and built. A laser-induced breakdown spectroscopy system, or LIBS, for detection of chlorides on the canister. Electromagnetic acoustic transducers, known as EMATs, for crack detection. A thermocouple probe for canister surface temperature measurement. And a Geiger-Müller tube for gamma radiation. Now I'd like to introduce Haman Song, a PhD student working with Professor Popovich at Illinois, to discuss the non-destructive inspection system for concrete overpack structures.
The Illinois team developed an automated contactless NDI system to inspect horizontal overpack systems. The NDI system consists of an L-coupled transmitter, MEMS receiver array, and an automated scanner. Our contactless NDI system was applied to large-scale concrete samples under the environment promoting ASR damage. Experimental results demonstrated that the ASR damage can be successfully detected and further localized within the scanned region for the case of reactive samples. The result from the control sample showed no indications of damage. In a separate effort, we developed an NDI system to inspect vertical overpack systems. The system is based on semi-coupled scanning guided wave measurements, and the purpose is to quantitatively characterize the interface bonding condition between the steel clad and the underlying concrete layer. The NDI system was applied to lab-scale samples with various interface bonding conditions. Experimental results show that the interface bonding condition can be quantitatively characterized and the results are repeatable. The experimental results also showed good agreement with numerical simulation results.
Measurement of canister surface temperature profiles aids management of spent fuel through thermal model verification. It also provides input for stress corrosion modeling. The thermocouple probe has a small thermal mass enabling rapid contact measurements. A miniature Geiger-Müller tube is used to measure the gamma radiation inside the third car. The sensing system was tested with an exempt cobalt-60 source. Now let me introduce Xuan Shao, a PhD student working with Professor Jovanovic at the University of Michigan, to tell you about the LIBS system for detection of chlorides on the canister surface.
Laser-induced breakdown spectroscopy, or LIBS, was chosen to perform a remote measurement of trace chlorine concentration on the canister surface. We developed a fiber-coupled, deployable LIBS system that comprised of 2 parts, a cart-mounted laser and spectroscopy instrument module, and a remote optics module. Only the remote optics module is carried by robots, while the bulkier and more environmental sensitive components of the system are placed outside of the cask. The two components are connected through a 25-meter optic fibers, such that the high-power laser probes can be sent, and the plasma emissions can be collected for analysis. The system employs a double-pulse laser and time-gated spectroscopic analysis. Our lab results show a high sensitivity of 10 mg per square meter can be achieved. The external component of the LIP system can be easily fit on a single cart. Our cart assembly has been extensively tested. We show that it can be readily assembled and realigned following transport to the measurement location. The remote optics module, which is located in the middle car, is designed to be pressed down by a pneumatic actuator to ensure a reproducible working distance when taking LIP's measurement. The optic fibers were bundled together with other cables that connect the robotic delivery component of the PRINSE system with its externally located component. We have demonstrated a full integration with the PRINSE robotic delivery system in an experiment conducted on the Penn State dry cast storage mockup. The spatial resolution of the LIP screening can be as small as 1 mm. LIP's measurement on each measured location took less than 1 second to be completed, with the chloron concentration output available in real time.
The stainless steel canister contains multi-pass full-penetration welds, whereby the heat-affected zone has high tensile residual stresses and chromium-depleted grain boundaries, making the material susceptible to chloride-induced stress corrosion cracking. The welds of most concern are at the bottom, around the circumference, and in the axial direction. The guide channels inside the overpack limit access. Any non-destructive inspection technique requiring direct access to the canister surface, such as visual, ultrasound, and eddy current, is severely limited. But ultrasonic shear horizontal, or SH waves, can propagate long distances. In fact, they can circumnavigate the canister many times. SH waves can be generated and received by compact, non-contact, environment-tolerant electromagnetic acoustic transducers, EMATs. In addition, SH waves interact with cracks oriented both transverse to and along the wave propagation direction. The canister inspection for crack detection starts at the bottom weld. If the axial weld is nearby, then it is inspected next, followed by the circumferential weld. Then the sensor train is moved to the next gap between guide channels, and the process is repeated until all 16 gaps have been utilized. The crack detection system was tested on a canister mock-up having realistic closed crack-like flaws that are not visible. It was a blind test. All flaws larger than the threshold size were detected, and 50% of those smaller than the threshold were also detected. And now Jen Bracken, a graduate student from Professor Brennan's team at Penn State, will tell you about the robotics delivery system.
The inspection sensors are packaged in a robotic train. The train is inserted via a delivery arm, which is supported at the top of the canister using the vent mount mechanism. The vent mount system keeps the delivery arm in place while the robot is being deployed. Here, Professor Brennan is demonstrating the attachment of the vent mount to an unloaded canister that has been lowered into a pit for easy access. After the vent mount is attached, we deploy the delivery arm, which carries the robotic car train to its initial position on top of the canister. Here, you can see the arm inside the cask on top of the canister. The end of the arm can swivel to the right or left, which allows us to inspect any of the channels inside the cask. Once the arm is in the proper location, we actuate the sensor car train. The train leaves the area we call the garage and then moves up over the hump at the end of the arm. This hump prevents the sensor train from wedging or jamming when the cars enter the channels inside the cask. After the sensor train moves over the hump, it travels down the side of the cask until it reaches the bottom. A winch attached to the vent mount then slowly moves the robotic car train up the cask while the sensor cars take measurements. After the sensor train has completed making the measurements, it returns to its garage. At that point, we can choose to rotate the arm to inspect another channel, or we can choose to extract the robotic system. Throughout the process, video is collected and all data are synchronized from the sensors to an external data collection system. After all the measurements are complete, we remove the robotic system from the canister.
The PRINSE team gave a technology demonstration to 47 people at Penn State on September 26, 2017. The PRINSE performed well, but much work remains to transform the prototype to a reliable product. Please contact me, Cliff Lissenden, or other team members if you have questions, applications, or ideas for future directions.